Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to our church service this morning. We're in a little bit of a unique way this morning. This is our second Sunday that we are not meeting as a congregation here at the church because of the coronavirus, and we're in our makeshift studio here at the back of the church. But I believe God can speak to us today in spite of our separation. We're here because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, celebrating the first day of the week. I think it'd be valuable for us to begin by a word of prayer for our leaders and our healthcare providers, tremendous amount of pressure and weight on them. Let's just bow our heads for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity to be alive and well, our sound thinking, and I pray that you would especially give direction and wisdom to our government leaders, strength for our healthcare providers in these challenging times. We put our faith and trust in you and ask that you would speak to us this morning as we look into your eternal word. Thank you for its living power and the hope that lies in it. So I pray that you would bless each one in our congregation, each of the listeners this morning. We want to give ourselves wholly to you. Thank you for Jesus. Amen. Well, I would rather see your smiling faces this morning, your eagerness to listen to God's word, but we will worship together in this way this morning. I've titled the message, God Speaks Through the Storm, and it's from Psalm 46. So if you will, turn with me in your Bibles to Psalm 46. I want to give a little bit of introduction here. Bible scholars attribute this psalm to the deliverance of Jerusalem from the Assyrian army. Hezekiah was the king of Judah, and he was a good king. We find this account in 2 Kings 18 and 19, and also in 2 Chronicles chapter 32. We know that Hezekiah was a good king because he tore down the high places, he destroyed the images, and he cut down the groves, all the Baal worship. And the Bible says that he trusted in the Lord God of Israel. Now there was a challenging king at that time, the leading king, the king of Assyria, whose name was Sennacherib. He came out and camped against the cities of Judah to overthrow them with his tremendous armies. They were the known power force in that day. They had chariots of iron. And most of the battles were fought by foot soldiers and maybe even horsemen. But when the foot soldiers would hear these chariots coming through the land, chariots of iron, it would strike fear in the soldier's heart because the ground would shake from the tremendous army power that the Assyrians had. So King Sennacherib surrounded Judea and the city of Jerusalem, and he began to belittle the God of Israel. He did it in a letter to Hezekiah, and also his soldiers shouted in discouraging things up to the soldiers on the wall. So Hezekiah was a wise king. He told the soldiers not to respond to the enemy, and they shouted up and said, "You're not going to be able to withstand our army. All the other nations around have fallen to us, and you're going to fall as well." Well, Isaiah the prophet got this message, and he sent a letter to Hezekiah saying, "Do not fear the Assyrians, for God will deliver Judah from them." So Hezekiah took the letter and he laid it before the Lord in the temple, and he prayed. He prayed that in spite of the strength of the Assyrians, God would show himself strong by saving them from this wicked nation. But he especially prayed that God, that the kingdoms of the earth will know that you are the Lord God and the only one. Well, that night, the angel of the Lord went through the camp of the Assyrians and he smote 185,000 soldiers. So in the morning, when King Sennacherib woke up, they were all dead corpses laying around him. And the Bible says that Sennacherib was so shocked and ashamed that he went home. Now, the Hebrew word for shame not only includes the feeling or the reality of shame, but it also means that he was confused. I can't imagine the most powerful army in the world the leader of that, losing his entire army, he went home ashamed. And while he worshipped back home in the house of his own god, Nisroch, his two sons rose up and slew him there. And the Bible says that the nations around them revered the God of the Israelites, and many brought gifts to the Lord at Jerusalem. It's a wonderful story of how God protects his people. And so this psalm, Psalm 46, is written out of that experience, and it's connected with the next two psalms, Psalm 47 and 48. So we have three psalms together, connected together. Psalm 46 represents God as a refuge. Psalm 47, God as a ruler. And Psalm 48, God as resource, not a resource, God as resource. And they are psalms of triumph. Our text this morning, Psalm 46, refers to the holy city and the security of its citizens. This is a psalm that's been used by many generations for reassurance by the people of God. And the song, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God," comes out of this text. So today, in our day of strain and calamity, it's fitting that we turn to it again, because it gives us courage and assurance of who God is in himself, and it renews the sense of security for those who trust in him. So let's read Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will not we fear, though the earth be removed, though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. There is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her, she shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. The heathen raged, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Selah. Come, behold the works of the Lord. What desolations hath he made in the earth? He maketh wars to cease unto the end of the earth. He breaketh the bow and cutteth the spear in sunder. He burneth the chariot in the fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Selah. This emphasis, Psalm 46, is on the presence of the Lord with his people. The first thing I want to look at, and I'm going to break this down into three sections. The first section is verses 1 through 3. And the first thing we want to talk about is God as our refuge and strength. That statement signifies a fortress of safety, a shelter to hide in when all around seems to be falling apart. And I want to note that God is unmovable and unchangeable. He's unchanging. So when we read in the Bible and we understand who God is, we see about his son Jesus, it's the same God today. So what are we going to learn here? The psalmist begins with language that describes the most violent forces in nature. He talks about the earthquake and the storm. And then later on, he includes the violent force of nations, which is war. All these things can cause fear and concern in our lives. An earthquake is very, very troubling, because it's a destructive thing in nature. Mountains are a symbol of security, stability to us. They're made of rocks and tall trees. So if a storm were to come abruptly while you were outdoors, you would look for a cliff or a rock to hide behind so that the wind and rain couldn't get you. But if the earth itself shakes and trembles, there's no time to run or hide. It's very unsettling and frightening. The landscape all of a sudden changes, and it becomes in ruins. What about a storm? A storm often quickly raises the water level, and it creates flooding. Flooding and strong currents sweep away anything in its path, leaving a path of utter destruction and sometimes even death. Storms can destroy in hours or minutes what takes a lifetime to build. So when the most unstable things, or when I want to say when the most stable things in life become unstable, the Bible says we don't need to fear because the unchanging character and stability of God. So most of us have lived long enough to see the destructive power of nature, but even these things cannot erode God's enduring throne. They cannot produce fear in the hearts of those who know God. So we have established in the first section, verses 1 to 3, God is our refuge and strength. That's unchangeable. The second section of verses talks about a river flowing from God, verses 4 to 7. The writer here suddenly shifts to a picture of the city of God. It's enriched and fed by the constant stream of the river, running from the dwelling place of God. And we see that God's in the center of it. He's in the center of this great city. But I want you to notice a contrast here. The contrast is inside and outside of that holy city. Inside that holy city, it says there's a tabernacle. There's a river of life flowing out of it that makes everyone glad who drinks of it because of its satisfying ability. Now, outside are the nations who have rejected God. They have raged against God and his authority over them. They have ignored him. They mock him. They scorn him. They've tried to overthrow him. They live in upheaval and turmoil. That's the picture outside the city of God. And in all of the confusion of the nations, God is reigning over all. He offers anyone to drink of the river of life that flows out from him. And he's commanding the storm to cease. And this is the message. God is declaring his determination to be exalted. God wants to be exalted. Well, let's talk about this river that's coming out of this holy city. What is the river? And what is it that's flowing from God? The fascinating thing is there are references at each end of the scriptures. We're going to call them book ends. Okay, I think this is very fascinating. Genesis chapter 2, verse 10 tells us that in the Garden of Eden, a river went out of it to water the garden. Okay, it was the place where God walked in the cool of the day to commune with his creation. And Adam and Eve were the most prized part of God's creation. So there's a river in the Garden of Eden flowing out to water it. Now at the other end of the scriptures, we have Revelation 22. John is shown of what is to come, the holy city, New Jerusalem, and also heaven. Revelation 22, 1 and 2 says, "And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river, there was the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits, and yielded her fruit every month, and the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations." So we notice here in Revelation that the river comes from the throne of God and of the Lamb. And its life-giving message is the eternal living God. The message is in the Son of God, the man Jesus Christ, who came to do the will of the Father. Everything done by Jesus while he was here was a reflection of the Father. Okay? There was healing, assurance, guidance, wholeness, life that never has an end. This is the message of God coming out of the throne. Everything that Jesus did was a reflection of the Father. So Jesus is our channel to the Father. We need to take on his life and cross and follow him. Jesus himself said to the woman at the well, "Whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life." Wow, that's God's Spirit coming in and working through us, providing life to those who see its message. The third and final section of verses here in Psalm 46 is verses 8 to 11. I want you to look at verse 8. He says, come behold the works of the Lord. What desolations hath he made? That's kind of puzzling in a way that God would make desolations, but most likely the writer is referring to the 180,000 dead Assyrian soldiers that were destroyed by the angel of the Lord. Behold the works of the Lord. What desolations hath he made? The Bible is full of illustrations how God defended those who trust in him and brought them down, brought those down who were proud. The book of Genesis talks about the Tower of Babel and how he scattered them because of their desire to be lifted up into the heavens, establish a name for themselves. God was able to scatter them. The book of Genesis, the Egyptians were destroyed by the 10 plagues and he brought his people out from bondage. The book of Daniel tells about Nebuchadnezzar, how he was proud in all the things he accomplished and did, and he lifted himself up and exalted himself, and God brought him down like an ox, and he was eating grass until he was humbled. The book of Acts tells us about King Herod and how that he gave a speech, and the people worshipped him as though he was a god, and the Bible says that he was struck with worms. And he was eaten by worms. Maybe more recently, we think about the sinking of the Titanic. The proud owners of that ship said not even God himself could sink it. And on the first voyage, the Titanic sunk. And I think there's a warning for us here today as well, as a nation and also individually. We had a feeling of euphoria, and we had a statement where our economy is recession-proof. There's nothing that could take it down. And in a few weeks' time, we have the stock market crashing. Jonathan Edwards said, God is able to avenge himself on all those who oppose his sovereignty. What do we mean by sovereignty? Well, God has no equal. He's fully in charge. God will be honored. God does not even need to defend his ways because they're higher than our ways, and God is worthy of our praise. So in times of uncertainty, I think our testimony should reflect the assurance and confidence that the three Hebrew boys said before they were thrown in the fiery furnace. They knew that their God was able to save them, but they said, if not, we still will not bow down to the golden image that is set up for us to worship. Okay? We know that God is able to save us. And even if he doesn't, we're going to still serve him. Verse 10 is a very familiar verse, but it's easier said than done. And this is important for us. Be still and know that I am God. We have two commands here. The first one, be still. And that has two aspects to it. The enemies of God and the people of God. The enemies of God are to be still. They are to threaten no more because God is infinitely above them. And the message to be still is for the people of God. They are to tremble no more. We have no need to fear. So here's an important aspect for us this morning. We need to stop the frantic pace of keeping up with the Joneses, keeping up with the news, keeping up, running, collecting, gathering things for security. Stop the frantic pace of keeping up. Sit and be still. Meditate on the fact that God knows what's going on and what he has done in the past. Meditate on that, what God's done in the past. Understand that message that's flowing from the throne, the river, the stream that flows out from the city of God. Allow him to speak to you through that river. So the first command is to be still. The second command is recognize God's sovereignty, his ultimate power. Okay? To those who know God, this is a comfort. To those who mock God or disdain his authority, it's a warning. Okay? Be still and know that I am God. If God cannot rule, he will overrule. The Bible reassures us that the Lord is slow to anger and plenteous in mercy. But when nations persist in wickedness in spite of his patience, then with an overrunning flood, he will confound and destroy them. Okay, that's the kind of God we serve. So the final thing, the most important thought for us this morning is this. It's found in verse 7 and verse 11. We have the same verse twice for our encouragement. The Lord of hosts is with us. Okay? The personal presence of the Spirit of God secures the safety of his people. We find that God met Jacob at Bethel when he was running. He was running away from home. God met him at Bethel and promised him, I will never leave thee or forsake thee. We find that in Genesis 28. That story is there. And the writer of Hebrews reminds us that, Hebrews 13:5, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. God secures the safety of his people. And then when Jesus came, God sent his only son into the world as a baby. Joseph was told by the angel that they should call his name Emmanuel, which is translated God with us. God is committed to keeping his promise. He is going to honor his promise to be with us. I want to end with this illustration. At the end of John Wesley's life, it was marked by the rough and toilsome life of a traveling preacher, and at the age of 88 years old, he was very weak. He was on his deathbed, hardly having enough strength to be heard. He mustered up what little energy he had left, and he said, the best of all is that God is with us. And then he rallied all of his strength, and he raised his feeble hand, and he said it again, the best of all is that God is with us. If you don't know about the stream that makes glad the city of God, it's found in the person of Jesus Christ. He has already overcome our worst enemy, death, and the Bible says that he has made it a footstool. That's a beautiful word picture. Okay, he's propping his feet on his enemy's territory. Jesus now is our advocate to the Father. He's interceding for us, and he has sent his Holy Spirit to dwell in the hearts of those who believe in him, to reassure us with his seal on our lives. So regardless of the outward circumstances, we can have peace. The Bible says, peace that passes human understanding. I want to close this morning with a song by the African Children's Choir. It's a song that has encouraged me many times over the years, and I hope it will do the same for you this morning. It's a medley called I've Got Peace Like a River. So here they are. God bless you.